All glory be to Christ indeed. He is indeed our King. Shall now go into responsive reading. Be taken from Genesis chapter 8, verses 20 to 22, followed by chapter 9, from 1 to 17. Let us read this responsively. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall never cease.
And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything.
But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast, I will require it from men. From this fellow man, I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image.
And you, be fruitful and multiply. Increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it.
Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you. As many as came out of the ark, it is for every beast of the earth I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be flood to destroy the earth.
And God said, This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you, for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth.
When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bowl is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. Together?
God said to Noah, This is a sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth.
Thank God for this precious reading of His Word. And before we call upon the messenger today, let us pray for our children. Dear Lord, thank you. Thank you that all the children here and all over the world are created in your own image. You have created them boys and girls, enable them to see Jesus. Let them know that Jesus loves them. Grow their affection for Jesus. In His name we pray. Amen. Children, you may leave for your class. The Lord's messenger this morning is our brother, Danny Chua. His message, God's covenant with Noah. Very good morning. Morning. Welcome to the 1030 family at Zion Bishan. I'm Danny, one of the ministry staff here. Especially warm welcome if you are new, joining us for the first time. We'd love to get to know you. You're right in the middle. You join us right in the middle of our series in the book of Genesis. We want to especially welcome those who are joining in on live stream as well. We do hope you be able to gather with us physically soon. Well, as we wait for the parents to return, as they send their children to their classes, would you please keep your Bibles open? You might find the bulletin helpful for you. Scan the QR codes around you in the pews. Or shall we pray as we begin? Our Father in heaven, as we search your scriptures, as we behold your promises, we ask that you will lead us to your Son, Jesus, so that we may find life in him. Amen. I take you as my wedded wife, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love, to lead, to cherish, and to serve with, till Christ returns or death do us part. According to God's holy word, and for this I give you my solemn pledge. Don't worry if you've just woken up and you're surprised at what's happening. It's not a wedding ceremony. You're here for the 10:30 service. You're in the right place. Friends, those are the words, covenant promises, that a man and woman exchange at their wedding. Do you know what happens next after they say these words? They exchange rings. Rings that are a token, a sign of their covenant. And then they say these words, I give you this ring as a sign of my vow, a pledge of my love. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen. Remember these words? Some of you are looking at each other. Wedding rings symbolize covenant love between husband and wife. Promises that they've pledged to each other for life. When times are hard in a marriage, rings declare the covenant reality. When love becomes cold in a marriage, rings testify. We've made promises to each other. God will help us to keep them. So if rings represent covenant love, let me ask you, what does a rainbow represent? What does a rainbow represent? In our passage today, we hear God's answer to this question. A rainbow signifies a divine covenant, a covenant from God. Listen to these very important words again. Chapter 9, verse 12. This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that's between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. Friends, a bow or rainbow in the clouds will signify, always signify, God's covenant. Ancient promises made to Noah that still stand today. But first, what exactly is a covenant? Do you know what it means? Very Christian word, huh? A covenant is an intimate relationship
between two people is faithful commitment. To be precise, it's not a relationship between people who never knew each other. It's not a new kind of union. It's a formalizing, a pledging, a confirming of an already existing relationship. So in earthly marriage, usually, it's between two people who were dating or already engaged, people who already love each other. So this intimate relationship of commitment and loyalty, walking closely with one another, oneness, that's the kind of relationship God had with Noah. Remember? It's that relationship that preserved Noah in that great and destructive flood. After that huge and total judgment came on the earth, do you remember what Noah did? He offered a sacrifice. He made an atonement for sin. Noah, who is the son of the faithful line, he walks in the footsteps of his fathers. Like Abel, who offered right sacrifices. Like Seth, who called upon the name of the Lord. Like Enoch, who walked with God and he was not. Noah knew God, so he knew what to do. It's blood that's needed, sacrifice, atonement. And then how did God respond? Can you recall? God was pleased with Noah. In fact, this covenant we read about today is God's response to Noah. That's how God responds to him and his sacrifice. But now you might ask, why are we paying so much attention to this covenant? Why? Is it because we want to be very intense about the Bible and nerdy about these kind of things? It just seems so complicated. Well, brothers and sisters, we want to care about covenant because they are windows into our God's heart. A covenant is a window into our God's heart. It tells us who he is, what he's like, what he's going to do about sin. So if God were the divine military general leading the cosmic war against sin and evil, then covenants are his key mission strategies, his battle order plans for his people. If God were the head of his family of faith, then covenants are his intimate family meetings, where he sits down with his children and he tells them, here's the plan for the future, here's the blueprint for our home. If God were the supreme king of the whole universe, then covenants are his royal decree. It's him telling the whole world, watch very carefully. Here's how I'm going to write history. Another way to see it is this. If covenants, if reading the Bible is like a journey of knowing God, it is, then covenants are key milestones, checkpoints on the journey. As God makes covenants with Adam, Noah, Moses and Israel, David and Jesus, we start to see where things are headed. Where are we on this journey? So that being said, what does this covenant with Noah show us? It shows us a faithful God who keeps his promises to humanity. A faithful God who keeps his promises to humanity. Come with me to chapter 9, verse 8 again. Please listen to these important words. Chapter 9, verse 8. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. It, this covenant, is for every beast of the earth." Verse 11, "I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." I trust that, like myself, some of you are perhaps confused about what's going on here. We get that God makes a covenant with Noah, a human being. He's the righteous man, son of the faithful line. God plans to save the world through him. But why in the world does this covenant also include creation, the living creatures. Did you notice that? Why does this covenant include the living creatures, the world of Adam as well? This seems very strange at first, but I think it tells us something about our Creator God. Remember, covenants are a window into His heart. I believe this tells us God's commitment to His creation and to His children. This shows us God's commitment to His creation and to His children. We've got a few hints here that tell us that. First, the Lord uses this very specific word, I establish my covenant with you. In other words, I confirm my covenant with you. This means God isn't creating something new. He's not writing a new contract with Him. God is confirming something already in place, an original covenant that's already in place. This is the earlier covenant made with Adam and with creation. With Adam and creation. Remember how all things began in the world? How creation started? God looked at His creation. He saw that it was good. He looked at His children, Adam and Eve, saw that it was very good. Then He gave them some instructions, be fruitful, multiply and fill the earth with God's image, with my goodness. But here's the thing, friends, that we normally overlook. Here's the thing. Yes, God commands man to be fruitful and multiply, but God also commands the living creatures to be fruitful and multiply. Have you seen that before? He also commands the living creatures to be fruitful and multiply. Again, this seems very strange. Or it could tell us something about our God. I believe this tells us our God loves His creation. The works of His hands are beautiful to Him. Are they not beautiful? He wants to fill the whole earth with all of His glory, yes, but all of His creation as well, all the good things that have come from His mouth and His hands. The life of God is just so wonderful. He wants all the earth to be filled with it. So it's true on one hand that you and I, children of God, people made in the image of God, will reflect Him, will show off His glory in a very unique way. But God also demands that all creation would speak of Him, declare His glory and goodness. That's why the psalmist would sing of this. Remember the psalmist? You might have seen that before. They would command the trees of the field, the sun, moon, and stars, the living creatures of the sea. All creation, the psalmist say, come and praise the Lord, declare His glory and goodness. In other words, God made a covenant first with Adam to bless people, humanity, but also with creation to reflect His glory. God made a covenant with Adam to bless His children, but also with creation to show off His glory. See, this must be why at the end of the Bible, at the end of God's redemption plan, what do we read about? We read of a new creation, not just a new humanity, not just new bodies that are free from sickness, not just a new place to live with God in. We read of a new creation, the new heavens and new earth. Or as Jesus declares, I am making all things, everything new. Brothers and sisters, this is why God now confirms, reaffirms that first covenant with Adam and creation. This is why now God confirms, reaffirms a covenant with Noah, the new Adam, and a renewed creation after the flood. We see here a God who is committed to His promises. We see here a loving God who is committed to His creation, committed to His children. Friends, this is not like all the gods of the ancient Near Eastern myths. They saw their creations as burdens holding them back. Men and women were slaves to them. Is this not true for us? We worship a God who is committed to all his promises, committed to his creation and his children. We have a faithful and loving and kind God. Do you know him? Isn't that incredible that this is our God? Friends, this is a God who will not let sin, he will not let evil derail his plans for us. This is a God who will not let sin obstruct all the good he has for creation. But still, sin, that poison that still flows in human hearts, still around, right, after the flood? The Lord sees that. He's grieved by that. Yes, God is committed to his creation and his children, yes, but what about sin? Still got to deal with that poison, right? That brings us to the next point. This covenant with Noah shows us sin must not destroy the earth again, mustn't fill the earth with violence again. The question is how? How though? What Genesis tells us is that God will do this through justice, through the means of justice. God puts in a law, which is a life for a life. Whoever kills a man will have to pay with their own life. A life for a life. Man is precious, made in God's image, so he cares deeply about this. Friends, this is the most basic form of justice. Do you realize? One life for another life. Justice stands on this very fundamental principle, the sanctity of human life, the inherent worth of a human being made in God's image. And so from this principle, Israel in Moses' time will have hundreds of laws about loving their neighbor, protecting especially the weak, honoring another image bearer of God. In fact, it is from this principle that we have any notions of justice. You realize that? Legal systems stand on this principle today. Life for a life. You know anything about equality? Do you trust in something called human rights? They are rooted in all of this. Justice that stands on the God-given value of each person, image bearers of God. And so God makes it such that justice, law, and order will restrain sin. It is justice, law, and order that will maintain a minimal level of sin, prevent social, global anarchy from bursting out into the world. It's justice, law, and order that will restrain human sin. And that's why the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, he will even urge Christians to pray. Pray for governments, rulers, and kings. Pray for those in charge of justice, law, and order. Not pray for them to be Christian so we can be a Christian nation, but pray for them to maintain social peace. Pray for them to maintain order so that Christians can live, the church can live in a godly way. Because God wants as many people to be saved as possible, so the gospel can go out in an ordered world. Friends, can you see how God's covenant with Noah and creation points to this? Sin must be restrained so salvation can be proclaimed. Now, having said that, we cannot be naive. You and I know that sin cannot just be restrained. It's not enough. Ultimately, sin must be destroyed completely from this earth. How can that happen, though? How will God achieve that without going back to a global flood to destroy all the agents of sin? That brings us to our next point. This covenant shows us sin needs more than a worldwide washing. More than a worldwide washing. See, human hearts, we've read, they remain wicked after the flood. So God declares we need a different plan in a way. There's a different approach to this. I will never again strike down every living creature. I will never again destroy the whole earth. Rather, while the earth remains, seed time, harvest, cold, heat, summer, winter, day and night, it shall not cease. Life will go on. The earth will turn on and on and on. God will never bring a destructive flood to destroy the whole earth again. And this is the reason he institutes that covenantal sign of the rainbow. Remember the rainbow? Let me ask a question. Do you know why it is a rainbow? Is it because it is cute and very child-friendly for a message of judgment? It's colorful, that helps. Why a rainbow? You don't have to overthink this. It's a rainbow because it appears when it rains. Think about how a rainbow is formed. Sorry to inflict this on you, primary school science. How is a rainbow formed? Whenever there is rain, water droplets, water in the sky. The sunlight shines through these droplets. Intelligent people tell me on Google, light slows down. It refracts. And many different color spectrums come out. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. And we see what we see as a rainbow in the sky. In other words, a rainbow appears when there's rain. A rainbow appears when that very thing that led to God's global flood, when that happens. This means that every single day when the heavens open, when the skies unleash upon our planet Earth, every single day as water drips down on billions of humans around the world, every single day as God's wrath threatens, one drop at a time, pitter, patter, one drop after another, every day, God remembers. Every single day, God remembers His promise to preserve the earth. He holds back His wrath. Doesn't matter, by the way, that you and I may not be able to see rainbows every day. That depends on some kind of scientific geometry, apparently. God in the heavens will see whenever there is rain. He will always keep His promise, and He will always hold His wrath back. So this is why that wonderful hymn that we love so much and we sang yesterday, if you were here at the anniversary service, tells us of God's faithfulness. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to God's great faithfulness, mercy, and love. So day by day and month by month, seasons by seasons, as the world turns on, life goes on as the sun rose today to shine into your room. God remembers all His promises to Noah and creation. And life goes on because of His faithfulness and mercy. The Lord Jesus would put it this way, God makes His sun shine on the good and on the evil. God makes His rain fall upon the just and the unjust because He is that kind and merciful even to sinners. But friends, at the end of the day, we still need to ask why. Why is God letting the world turn on? God, do you not see the world? Have you seen what's going on everywhere on this planet? Why is God letting things go on as they are? Why does God still tolerate with human sin? It's not like people go out there after a rain, look at a rainbow, and we want to repent, turn to God suddenly out of the blue. Why does God still tahan with this wicked world that hates Him every day? Oh, brothers and sisters, it's because God desires, God wants for as many children as possible to come home to Him, as many people as possible to turn back to their Creator. So when he keeps his covenant promises, when he's still patient today, it's because he wants more sinners to come home. This is why the Apostle Peter in the New Testament, when he looks at the flood, when he reads about Noah's covenant, Peter says, God, do you know that people are mocking you? Scoffers are laughing at you. They are looking at God and saying, where got such thing called judgment? Let us just live and be evil. Peter says, the wicked world is mocking the Creator God. He will not ever come to judge us, right? But friends, really, Peter says, really, the reason God keeps his promises, continues to let the world turn on, continues to let life roll on, is patience. He's patient. Hasn't forgotten his promises. He's patient with us. He doesn't want everyone to perish, but as many as possible to come to repentance. The question for us is, are any of us taking his patience for granted today? Friends, are any of us taking this patience for granted today? This is why we must conclude today, not with the sign of a rainbow, but with the sign of the cross. The rainbow ultimately signifies God's faithfulness, his mercy, his kindness. But we today have a greater sign and symbol. We have the cross, which is a sign of more than just tolerance, more than just God's long-suffering waiting. This is the cross of the long-promised Son, the faithful Savior who was crucified. Friends, this is the definitive message from God. His fierce judgment on sin, his gracious pardon on sinners. Look at the cross. Today, as we commemorate Reformation Day, as we heard earlier, it's only fitting that we celebrate the cross and what it signifies. It is right that we remember what turned the corrupt medieval church around. What led them away from wickedness back to their Creator God? It is this, the cross of Christ crucified. The cross of Christ was so dear, it was so precious to the many men and women of the Reformation. One of them was Martin Luther. He loved the cross. He spoke of it so much. He loved the Savior that the cross reminded him of. Luther, in fact, treasured the cross so much, he created a logo, here it is, and he wanted to put it on, or he did, put it on everything that he published. Why did he do that? Better marketing, good PR, looks nicer on the cover. It's quite nice, lah, you must admit, right? But Luther did that because he loved the cross. And so he wanted all of his teachings, all of his theology, everything about Martin Luther, he wanted it to be about one thing only, the cross of Christ crucified. And this is what he says about this logo. This cross reminds us that the crucified Christ saves sinners. The crucified Christ saves sinners. He is the answer to the wicked hearts of the world since the flood. So, brothers and sisters, in all things, let us return to the cross. When we do not know what God is like anymore, when we feel that He is not good anymore, let's return to the cross of Christ crucified. When our faith has become a little stale, when our Christian passion has fizzled out and got nothing left to give, let's return to the cross of Christ crucified. When life circumstances make us question, when we doubt, we worry that God's love is cold towards us, let us return to the cross of Christ crucified. When the wickedness of our hearts overwhelm us and guilt fills our mind, let us return to the cross of Christ crucified. It is here that we remember the covenant reality. The covenant reality for all who trust this Son. The Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. The Son of God loved me and gave himself for me. Friends, at this cross, you can hear the declaration of God to you. This is how far I have gone to deal with your wickedness and sin. This is how far I have gone to keep every promise of my word. My sons and my daughters, God declares, this is how much mercy and love I've poured out upon you. Would you return often to the cross of Christ crucified? Let's take a moment to reflect on these things and perhaps say a prayer of thanks to God. And I'll pray for us. Our Creator God and our dear Father in heaven, thank you so much that we can stand on your faithfulness to your promises. Thank you so much for our Lord Jesus and the cross he bore. Amen.